Welcome to today's session brought to you by Team Grade Up. I hope you all are doing really well and enjoying your weekend as well. Today is going to be a very important class in terms of the writer that we're looking at. Of course, Toni Morrison passed away at the age of 88. We are talking about an Afro-American writer who's trying to subtly portray the concept of racism. And multiple times, you know, there have been questions regarding Toni Morrison. There are beautiful videos also available where you can see how she herself is talking about it, that Toni Morrison was questioned that, you know, can you ever write a novel without looking at the topic of race? And, you know, here I'd like to quote Sadathasan Manto. Manto also says that, you know, if you think the times that I'm talking about or what I'm writing is unbearable, then let me just tell you that the times that I'm talking about is also unbearable. And from that same logic, you're able to see Toni Morrison, and she says, of course, I can talk about things besides racism, but racism is a reality when we are talking about the American context. So we will be looking at Toni Morrison, this Nobel laureate, the first Afro-American writer to get the Nobel Prize, to get the Pulitzer Prize for her modern gothic version of a novel which is famously termed as Beloved. Writer who started her career by writing The Bluest Eye, and post that the second novel which came in 1973 was Sula. And like I said, Beloved was the work for which she was getting the Pulitzer Prize. She's also been awarded the Nobel Prize. And this is a very, very interesting writer that we are talking about. And we're looking at a work which is not very well known, but it comes in your exam, right? It is a question that is asked in your exam. For instance, in one of your exams also, they're actually asked you the question about the opening of Sula. So you do get questions related to Sula, and you should be aware about it. It's actually one of the works that are a part of your must-read list. Okay, now how we've bifurcated today's lecture is we will very quickly look at some aspects of Sula, and you will also get an idea how you can approach texts through these crash courses on the YouTube platform. We'll try and give you as many opportunities of knowing how you can make notes on must-read writers, must-read works. Sometimes we will use infographics. Sometimes we will use how you can use notes in a format which is easier to remember. So you will get a lot of idea, and I'm sure they'll really benefit, especially in the category and domain of your must-read text. Okay, so let's very quickly dive into the discussion related to Sula. Now here I would want you to answer this question. Does anyone know who this person is? This woman that you're seeing right in front of you, who she is? Can anyone tell me? Good evening, everyone. Good evening. All right, what is the right answer here? What do you think? Who do you think is this person that we are able to? And you know, surprisingly, when we are talking about Sula also has a mention of the plague, so we can actually connect, especially during the time of the pandemic, we are able to easily associate. So who this person is? Does anyone know about this writer? Has anyone heard about this writer? Right, very good, Antara. That's great, that's great. Does anyone know who this person is? Who this person is that you're able to see? Okay, I can't really see. I can't really see any one of you answering. Anyone, any guesses, any wild guesses? I'll give you a hint. Sisterhood is Powerful is a book written by her. Okay, so Sisterhood is Powerful. Sisterhood is Powerful is a very, very famous book which is written. You know, the second wave of feminism is talking a lot about women's solidarity, how women are against women, how the second wave feminism was talking about the issue of friendship, especially friendship among women, and that's exactly how the concept of Alice Walker's womanism comes into picture. This is Robin Morgan, okay? If you are not aware about her, you can actually even search her a little. But Robin Morgan plays a very critical role. So Robin Morgan, like I said, is writing this work called As Sisters Powerful. During the 1960s, 70s, 80s, that is when the second wave of feminism was picking up at great speed. And people were talking about the fact that, you know, unfortunately, women are complicit in their own marginalization. By complicit, that means women are involved in their own marginalization, unfortunately. Women are participating in their own marginalization. Women are not bringing this bond of solidarity. Women are not helping other women. And this, unfortunately, was criticized by many people. Many people were actually criticizing. And that is the reason a lot of people, a lot of writers were stressing on the bond between women. The bond that each woman needs to have displayed towards each other was getting highlighted by writers like Robin Morgan. Robin Morgan was talking at length about the fact that how women need to have solidarity. Women must become friends. Women must coach each other, mentor each other, have friendships with each other. So this is actually the starting point for Sula, because Sula is also telling us about this friendship between Sula Peace and Nell Wright. And of course, you know, at the end, the question that I will ask you at the end of this video would be, do you think that their friendship actually goes sour? Or are they, because you know, Sula dies thinking about Nell, and Nell at the end is going to the grave of Sula. So have they actually, of course they're becoming enemies, like, you know, in between, but has their friendship dissipated? And I'm sure all of you can connect, you know, and that is the power of Toni Morrison, because we've all had friends, we've all had fallouts with friends, we've all had, you know, relationships, we've all had relationships where people have got estranged from all of us. So that is the beauty of Toni Morrison, that each person can actually connect with the novel, right? That is a very important aspect that you have to keep in mind. So Robin Morgan is the person. So do remember that whenever we talk about Sula, Sula is actually written at a time. It was written at a time when this theme of sisterhood being very powerful was a concept that was coming. So Robin Morgan, you saw the picture of Robin Morgan, right? A lot of people, for example, Miss Magazine was telling about the sexism that was there. Alice Walker was, of course, in The Color People, highlighting this bond between women that was required, that was important. So please remember that particularly when we are talking about the second wave of feminism, the second wave of feminism is highlighting the concept of womanism, the question of womanism, the concept of solidarity among women. Women need to become each other's best friends. They need to encourage each other. They should not be having this element of envy, this element of not trusting each other. They must rather support each other. Here I would want you to remember Virago, for instance, was actually a feminist press that was opening women writings. So womanism, solidarity is the starting point of the novel Sula. Okay, a lot of times we only think that Color Purple by Alice Walker is talking about the theme of womanism, and we very often forget Toni Morrison's 1973 novel Sula, which I want all of you to keep in mind, because this is a very important work. All right, now like, you know, whenever you're talking about women, women have always had the pressure of how the society is viewing them. We've got this concept of gaze, that how the society is looking at them. You know, Sula is having her grandmother Eva, and it is, of course, like a lot of you, if you will, you would have actually read Sula in your UG, PG, or as a part of any research project, you would have seen that, you know, Sula's grandmother Eva can actually be interpreted in Freudian methods also. So how you are talking about a community and the gaze of the community on women, and you know, here you can also compare it. If you remember when we were school kids, we used to read The Night of the Scorpion, and The Night of the Scorpion by Nizam Ezekiel was talking about how you know, the villagers were trying to interpret the stinging of the scorpion. They were not looking at rationality. So even though this is, like, you know, this entire novel is set in 1919 Ohio, the bottom is the place, the black community where you are having these people who are living, but at the same time they're just telling you that people are all the same. They're just like, you know, you always have to succumb to what is the pressure. You know, now what is this called? This is called the peer pressure now. It is called the peer pressure. So, unfortunately, we always have to acclimatize ourselves to what the society is wanting from us. That is also a very important point that the novel is trying to address, that what is the entire relationship between a woman and the community that she is a part of, all right? So that is something that you have to keep in mind, that, you know, how the society is perceiving me, what is the role of the society. So do remember that this particular novel is raising some very pertinent issues, all right? Also, Toni Morrison was one of the few people, the first few people, even though we now consider Buchi Emcheta the African writer coming from Nigeria. She's writing The Second Class Citizen. She's of course talking about the joys of motherhood, writer Buchi Emcheta, talking about the violence that was there, the physical violence, the domestic violence that was there. But Toni Morrison had also highlighted the same thing. Right, Toni Morrison had also spoken about domestic violence, domestic abuse, and you know, domestic violence and domestic abuse is actually a microcosm of what happens to women in the outdoors, right? It is a microcosm. Of course, we are physically getting hurt, but that's also because of our dignity being such, right? Our identity as a second-class citizen. That's what Buchi Emcheta also talks about. We are treated as second-class citizens, unfortunately, even today in certain cases. And that is the reason we don't see a lot of women occupying powerful leadership position or being limited in number. A lot of women, we don't have a 50% population in the parliament also in terms of women's representation. So you are able to see that domestic violence, Morrison is saying, is actually microcosm of the subtle violence that is outside. So, of course, how domestic violence is there, women are accommodating to the violence. So, you are able to see that Morrison was trying to bring across these very important issues. The issues of infidelity. So Sula, for example, would touch and right now everything will be crystal clear. So everyone who is not aware about Sula, just hang on a bit. I'm sure after this video, all of you will be able to give a lecture also on Sula in terms of plot. We'll make it very simply understandable to all of you. Okay, so please do remember this, that you're able to see that women, how they are facing domestic abuse. And that's a very unfortunate reality. That's a very, very unfortunate reality. I remember one of the students had actually presented when I was conducting one of these MPhil interviews. So they had this plan and vision of writing a research paper on Sula and the depiction of domestic violence in Afro-American writings and the reality that still persists. And that was a beautiful, touching piece altogether. Okay. Now here, please keep that in mind, that Sula was considered to be very radical. Now, what I want you to understand is, when this work got published, okay, we are talking about the 1970s, where a lot of people are still having the Eurocentric view. A lot of white male writers are writing, so they had kind of put Toni Morrison's work as an Afro-American literature work. But remember, it is actually raising very dynamic questions. For example, we are not Afro-Americans, but you know, we can still connect. I, for instance, you know, when I read this work, it was so comparable, because, you know, we've all had relationships where we were so close, and then we suddenly, because either these days, because we are not keeping in touch, so we fall out. But then that person still remains in your heart. You can't really do without that person. It can be a friend at school. It can be a family member also, right? So Sula is raising these very important concerns about friendship fallout. Because, you know, it's a very common thing. I'm sure you must have heard this very famous English saying, that, you know, familiarity breeds discontent, or familiarity breeds a lot of detestation. The more I know of you, the more I'll not like you, right? So that is unfortunately a hard fact. But that doesn't mean that that person just goes away from your life, right? So that is something that it can be anyone, right? It can be literally anyone. It can be your father who passed away and you had a really deep love and affection for your father. It can be anything in your case, right? So this is telling us about a non-sexual relationship. Not all kinds of love are Freud, of course Freud will have a different opinion, but sometimes you're also having non-sexual platonic love for the other person, and it's like, you know, this real amazing love, right? And here you are able to see this inseparable love between two women. And I will ask you this question after we complete this, that do you think That Sula and Nell, are they still friends or are they not? And I'm sure you will all agree that, you know, that the bond actually, of course, on the face of it, on the front of it, in terms of the societal ways and the societal customs and hurdles, they weren't friends, they were enemies. But if you look at it, they were friends, right? Because Sula dies thinking about Nell, even after betraying her, all right? And Nell goes to the grave of Sula at the end, and she's crying badly. She's crying, weeping badly. All right, so please remember that it's telling us that unfortunately the society is encouraging us to dislike. The society, the male-centric society, wants us not to be friends, you know, of each other. But otherwise, we're all there. We all have love and affection for each one of us, right? So I'm sure if you read, and that's the beauty of Toni Morrison, if you read Toni Morrison, you'll be able to connect immediately. Okay, now here we come. If you have a pen and a paper, just get a pen and a paper and draw it out, okay? Just draw it out, okay? Now, this is Sula, the eponymous heroine. Eponymous, of course, I hope all of you are aware about it when we are talking about the name of the book being the same as the name of your writer. So Sula is the eponymous character, her mother Hannah and her grandmother Eva. So perhaps if you want, you can draw, like, you know, Sula, and there you are having her mother Hannah. And then you are having Eva. Now, Eva, of course, will come back again because Sula, when she comes back at the age of 17, Sula leaves the bottom for college. Okay, and also the setting is Ohio. The bottom is the place where the setting is there. All right, the bottom is the place where the setting is there. Okay, so this is the first important character. And Sula's friend is Nell, and Nell's mother is Helen. Helen is a very conventional mother. She's a very, very conventional mother. And you know, Sula is actually starting on with a point. Of course, there's this description of a farmer's episode which we'll talk about towards the end of the lecture. Don't worry about it. But I want you to be very clear with the major plot details, okay? Now, here, this is a very important point, which is actually a quotation from the first few chapters. It's really hard not to be like the ones around you. You know, unfortunately, many a times we might have a radical opinion. Remember, classroom students today at 3 p.m. class, we were talking about anti-dogmatic view. We were talking about intellectual emancipation. Critical theory introduced by the Frankfurt School was talking about how we all need to be absolutely free. Right, we need to be absolutely free in terms of questioning the things that are there in society. If I'm wearing a sari, if I'm wearing a suit, if I'm wearing a burqa, I should not question anyone else who's probably wearing something different. I should accept them. So that is a part, of course, that is there. But unfortunately, we always retain something. You know, the community from which we are hailing, we always tend to have that in us, right? So that is a very important point that is raised. Okay, now the beginning, what you are able to see that Sula and Nell. So Nell is like, you know, Nell Wright and Sula Price are two friends, and they're inseparable. They're going to school together. They enjoy their friendship a lot. So this is basically the starting. This is basically the starting. Now what happens is that Sula and Nell, they are such great friends. They are going to school together. They are having fun together. They're trying to, you know, the world. There's a beautiful line if you read the actual novel, which talks about the fact that, you know, Sula and Nell had created their own little world, and things were much more comfortable after they both met each other. You know, so that is basically that they were feeling better in the company of each other, even though the times were difficult. But the friendship was making the world a better place. The friendship was making a world a better place. That is what you could observe. That is what you could notice. Okay. Now, there is one episode where bullies are disturbing them. Okay. So you can write it down also. Bullies are disturbing them. So their paradise is getting a little shaken. There are white boys who are, like, you know, bullying them. Oh, you black girls. And this is a concern that she had raised in the Bluest Eye also. That if I am not having conventional beauty, the society is not accepting me. The society is not accepting me, unfortunately. Or the society, for example, if I'm fat, for instance, like, you know, both me and my brother, because of our nani, like, you know, our grandparents, we were of the fatter side, and then later we reduced, and then we keep on putting on or whatever. But we've often been labeled, you know, as being of a particular kind. So in school, what happens is that we have a lot of these bullies, right? So people are calling you if you're not of a particular type. So there, the same thing is coming. And there's a beautiful critic who had written, you know, there was one criticism that says that, you know, Toni Morrison's Sula is presenting, you know, the girls in the bluest eye as having grown big a little. They've grown up a little. So there are bullies. Now what happens is Sula comes and Sula is trying to, you know, cut her finger. She cuts the tip of her finger. All right. And the way that Morrison describes, you're actually able to feel that she's cutting the finger. And when she cuts the finger and she tells and she shows it to the white boys, she's trying to demonstrate that get away from the paradise that Sula and Nell have created, otherwise she will cut their finger also. Okay, so the first episode is the episode of the bullies, but both of them are protected by Sula's actions. So Sula is cutting the tip of her finger. She wants to demonstrate that if they don't leave her life, she will actually do the same thing. Alright, the second episode is a secret, which is called the Chicken Little Secret. Sorry, this is a spelling error. It's little, okay? Which is famously called as the Chicken Little Secret. You know, many a times when we are playing, for instance, this was actually a news also. So once, you know, there were these, this was I think a couple of years ago, and you can check it on Google also. These school kids were playing doctor, and unfortunately, you know, they were trying to operate a child, and they actually killed that child in that entire play thing. So as children, many a times, you know, when you are trying to play, sometimes of course there are also accidents that take place. Now there is a secret. What happens is that Sula and Nell, they have gone a little outside. They've gone to this lake area, and here they actually come and meet this guy called Chicken Little. This Chicken Little is the nickname of this boy who is from their class, from their school. And what happens is Sula is like, you know, like you play ringa roses, and you're moving around, you're moving very fast. For instance, if I'm here, I've held you, and I'm trying to, like, you know, just play around with you. So that is what Sula is doing, and unfortunately her hand slips. So imagine I'm just like, you know, I'm having a child, and I'm just circling around all around, and suddenly my hand slips. Okay, my hand slips, but the child actually tosses away. And I don't know why am I laughing at this, but you know, I think 1.5 years ago, what had happened was that in Delhi NCR, what they had done is that they had banned e-rickshaws for some time. So you know why they had banned e-rickshaws? I mean, I'm so sorry. I'm feeling so bad that I'm smiling at it. But you know, the minute I was reminded of the news channel report and the way that he narrated this story, okay? So this woman was on the e-rickshaw, and what happened was a baby was in her hand, and this e-rickshaw, apparently the woman mustn't have held the child properly, this e-rickshaw did a kind of a topsy turn, and suddenly this child in her hand went and tossed inside a frying pan. So there was, like, you know, the pakoda frying pan, and the child went, and the child was completely burnt, and he died on the site. A similar kind of a thing, you know, the tossing of the child episode. So that's the same thing that happens with Chicken Little, poor chap. But both Sula and Nell, they decide that we'll not tell anyone. We will not be telling everyone. We will remain quiet. We'll not tell everyone about it. And that is a dark secret. Okay. So the first episode of the bullies, where Sula is cutting a finger and she shows it that you better stay away. The second is a secret. So why these two episodes are brought in the novel is to, of course, tell you about the friendship and also tell you about the deep bonds. Like, you know, we've often had these secrets. We've often had these, you know, these dark secrets with our friends, or some things that we've done, or some lie that we've spoken to the friends, to the family, right? So that is what you are able to see. Now what happens is that after they have completed high school, when they're 17 years of age, Nell gets married to Jude. She becomes a passive wife, whereas Sula is leaving. Sula leaves the bottom. Remember, the work is starting in Ohio, the bottom. The locality is the bottom. Sula leaves the bottom, and she is not coming till 10 years. So at the age of 17 years, you're able to see that Nell gets married at the age of 17. So the novel is starting in, like, you know, approximately 1919. Alright, and then after that, what you're able to see is after, after the completion of the high school, Nell is getting married, whereas Sula is leaving. Alright, and now Sula comes back after 10 years. Now, after 10 years, when she comes back, she's wearing expensive clothes and she's dressed up in a particular way, and her grandmother doesn't like it. Okay, so after 10 years, Sula comes. After 10 years, she's coming. So, Nell has got married to Jude. Nell has, lived for 10 years, and Sula didn't come. Now, Sula suddenly comes, and Sula returns to the bottom. Now, I will be telling you. When Sula comes to the bottom, there is also a plague that comes. There is also plague that comes, and all of us can now connect to the plague. Now all of us, unfortunately, we wish that we wouldn't have ever got a practical experience, but all of us, due to coronavirus, have now got a practical experience, right? We've got a practical experience of what the pandemic, what the plague looks like. A plague is like, many people are getting affected by it. So with the coming in of Sula, you are able to see that there is a coming in of the plague also, right? The plague also comes in. And we will talk about this coming of the plague, because that's a very important symbol. Because that is telling you how the society is still looking at you. Come what may, whatever advancement you make in the society will always have a superstitious view of looking at you, right? Right? The society will always have a superstitious view of looking at you. So we will discuss about this. Remember this part. Now Sula has come, and her grandmother Eva is like, what are you wearing? You need to get married. Look for a match for yourself. Why are you wearing such expensive clothes? And this is not, appropriate way of dressing up. And Sula, what she does is she places a grandmother in a nursing home. She's placing a grandmother in a nursing home, and she starts living with Nell and Jude. And that is when the betrayal takes place, because Sula is going to have this brief, she will make love to Jude, and that will be the betrayal. So this is the betrayal. She is, she's sleeping with the husband of her best friend. So that is a betrayal that we are able to see. So Nell is actually betrayed by both Sula as well as Jude. Because, she invited her friend, she let her friend stay with her. And now what she's able to see is that she's getting betrayed by both Jude as well as Sula. Now, Sula falls sick. Sula is falling sick. Now, when Sula falls sick, you should look at the reaction of the villagers. The villagers are like, this is Sula's own doing. She destroyed a house. So what you are able to see is that there is this plague of robins. We'll just talk about the plague of robins. Don't worry about it. So Sula is falling very, very ill. She's falling sick. She's falling severely sick. And many people are thinking that, it's a kind of a payback. The god is punishing you for your deeds. The god is not happy with what you have done. Many a times, that's exactly what I said, that, Nizam Ezekiel's the Knight of the Scorpion will constantly remind you of a parallel between how people behave, right? How people are having their genuine notions and rumors, so to say. Now, the fact that, Nell goes, she visits Sula in the hospital. She asks Sula that, why did you betray me? Sula tries to justify, but Nell is not convinced. Nell is like, no, I'm not convinced. And she goes back. But, Sula dies thinking of Nell. She dies thinking of friendship with Nell. Rather, that is the only time that she was very happy, when she was in the company of Nell. She thinks about this. And Nell also, towards the end, is actually visiting Sula's grave, and she cries bitterly. So if you look at it on the face of it, you will be able to see that both Nell and Sula have become enemies, right? Why? Because the society wanted them to be enemies, that if you have if you have probably slept with my partner, then technically the society will say that, okay, I'm not listening to any of your justifications, you're bad for me, you've betrayed me, because according to the societal norms and conduct. So Toni Morrison is of course asking that, that a dark secret also between the two friends has not really they shared such good bond together, But suddenly, with the growing up, it's not just their growing up, it's also their internalizing certain stereotypes or certain ways that, through which the society is living. So my question, of course, I will ask you this question towards the end also. Do you really think that their friendship was broken? Do you really think that their friendship was broken? And can friendship be broken? Of course, we say that, you know, okay, we are now no more friends. But is it even possible, especially when you're talking about either a family member or your bonds that you had at school? It's really not possible. You know, they'll have an indelible impact. So, you know, this is exactly whenever Sula is discussed in any platform. For example, Oprah Winfrey also started this club that, you know, you were reading The Black Artist or The Best of American Fiction. And she, when she was describing Sula, it's there on YouTube. You can check that video. She says that, you know, it's a story of having a friend and losing a friend. And we've all had fallouts, we've all had, like, you know, we've all had these moments with our friends. And that's the beauty of a book. If a book is actually reminding me of something from my own life, that is actually telling us that, yes, the book actually spoke to me as a reader. Right? And of course, it's raising very important concerns about a socially and racially divided town. You know, there's a beautiful saying that this novel is a novel, the howl. Toni Morrison said it's a howl. Howl is like a shriek of love and rage. It's love and rage together. So you are able to see that why Toni Morrison is becoming this first Afro-American to get the Nobel Prize deservedly, because of a subtle treatment of not just race issues, but life issues. She is bringing at the forefront issues which all of us would actually face. A very nuanced discussion that too. So very important aspects that you are able to see. Okay, now there's a symbol. Remember, Sula comes back after 17 years. That is clear to everyone. Sula's coming back after 70 years. And she's getting the plague of the robins. The plague of the robins is coming along with her. And you know what people are saying? That, oh, it's a symbol of evil. Many people have this way, right? They would interpret. And it's not always bad interpretation only. For instance, I remember, you know, when my father passed away, it was raining heavily. So people were saying that, you know, it's the heavens also crying. So of course, that's also an example of pathetic fallacy. But it is also telling us about how, you know, societies interpret certain decisions. Sometimes it's for us, sometimes it's against us. So how people are considering that the plague of robins is actually returning at the time of Sula. It is symbolic of evil. And Eva, the grandmother, look at it. The grandmother is actually thinking, because, you know, her granddaughter is not doing things that she would have wanted. So she is considering the plague to be an omen, and she thinks that, you know, Sula will inflict the evil around everyone. So you're able to see that the entire behavior of Sula is considered as a disease. Anything that the society has told you and you're not following, the society often considers that to be a disease. So the plague of robins is a very important symbol that, you know, the coming of Sula and the coming of the plague of robins is treated together. That is what you're able to see. So basically, this powerful story of two girls growing up together, and the friendship is actually, that is a question that I'm asking you again and again. They're not becoming enemies. Only they're becoming enemies according to the society. But Sula dies. The last thoughts of a dying person are of Nell, and Nell is crying after going to the grave of Sula. So this beautiful story of Nell Wright, Sula Peace, living in Medallion, Ohio, right, you're able to see, they're withstanding, remember? They're withstanding bullies. She cuts her finger and she says that, okay, you know, if you don't go away, I'll cut your finger. They're also having the Chicken Little episode, the dreadful, Chicken Little episode as a secret of how Sula was playing with the guy, and then she tossed the guy and he drowns, right? But unfortunately, Sula has become a pariah. There was a beautiful piece of criticism that compared the story in Middlemarch of two girls, the story of Vanity Fair and two girls, the story of Sula here, two girls, how you're always having, you know, the two girls will always be foils to each other. They'll be foil. What do we mean by foil? They will always contrast each other. Look at Elizabeth Bennet and Jane Bennet. Look at Helen Burns and Jane Eyre. These are all women who can be contrasted, They're all two sides. One is liked by patriarchy, the other is not liked by patriarchy and becomes a pariah. That is what you're able to see. And of course, Toni Morrison, we will be having more crash courses on Toni Morrison. But do remember that, you know, Toni Morrison, this graduate from Harvard and Cornell University, you're able to see that, you know, she is trying to capture the nuances that you're able to see in with regards to relationships, racism, the black identity. And, you know, we will be shortly having another session on black feminism, where we will talk about, of course, how Toni Morrison is playing a very critical role in the entire notion of black feminism. So do remember that, do keep that aspect properly in mind. Okay, after that huge bit I'm sure now at least you will be able to properly understand Sula Price as well as and Nell Wright and the relationship, the dark secrets that they have, the attack on of the bullies, the fact that, you know, after the age of 17 when Nell is getting married to Jude, Sula is then going and she comes back only after 10 years. The fact that, you know, Sula dies, the plague of Robins is there. Sula comes and the plague also comes in. But Sula is thinking about Nell when she dies, and Nell also goes to the grave of Sula. Feel free to connect on the Telegram channel from today onwards, because, you know, we always try every weekend to start something new. We've also started with tips of the day to just help you out with overall mentorship, overall how you can, have a great and exciting careers in the field of literature. Not just that, how you can tackle your day, how you can be more productive during the course of the day. So I'm sure that'll be helping. And otherwise also all the PDFs of all the lectures are provided on the platform, and you get an update of all the classes as well, right? There'll be some audio lectures also that we'll be starting soon. So that is something that we're working on. So please feel free to connect on the Telegram channel. That's Neerja UGC Net English. Your YouTube classes are conducted thrice a week. Of course, we have extra sessions also, but Tuesdays, Thursdays and Saturdays at 7 p.m. And this month, we are focusing on crash courses on writers and their works and their important aspects. All right, tomorrow, that is 16th of May, you are having a session on the YouTube platform at 7 o'clock, wherein we'll try and cover 50 plus words from M.H. Abrahams, okay? So this is a session that you are having at 7 p.m., where we'll try and cover 50 plus words from M.H. Abrahams. So do join in tomorrow. Okay, before we go ahead with any of the further topics, let's very, very quickly take this quick quiz. All right, all of you are ready. So let's start. This is the first question. Let's start. Let's see how many of you are able to answer it. Which of the following is a curtal sonnet? Which of the following is the curtal sonnet that you're having? A curtal sonnet is a 10.5-line sonnet. It's a 10.5-line sonnet. So what is the right answer? Very, very quickly. Let's see how many of you are able to answer this question correctly. Let's see how many of you get the right answer. Let's very quickly take a look at it. Prachi Rana, but I will be planning, of course, a mini module on Indian writers also. Don't worry about it. But nice, thanks for reminding me. Okay, now I don't know where that notebook is. Anyway, Prachi, but can you just write it in the very good, very good, great, great, great. Who was the first one to answer? But all of you have given the right answer. All of you have given the right answer. So it is The Pied Beauty by Gerard Manley Hopkins. J.M. Hopkins was the person who was starting on with the curtal sonnet, also called the 10.5-line sonnet. So it is actually 3/4, right? It's the 3/4 of a sonnet. So if you look at a sonnet, if you mathematically look at it, I'm sure you have wonderful classes of paper one, so all of you will be able to do the math together. So 3/4 × 8, if you do it right, what is the right answer that you get? That is 6. And if you multiply 3/4, so I hope you know that is how you work on the bracket. So it was a very mathematical conception. This is 2, this is 3, so 6 and 9/2, and 9/2 is nothing but 4.5. So it's a 10.5-line sonnet. There was a question that was asked that it is how much of the Italian sonnet? It is 3/4 of the Italian sonnet. It is 3/4 of the Italian sonnet because G.M. Hopkins was a very mathematical poet. He was very mathematically constructing his writings, okay? So that is what you're able to see. And when we are talking about the Kirtle sonnet is a curtailed sonnet. That means it's a shortened sonnet that you are having followed by G.M. Hopkins. A very important piece in Victorian poetry. A lot of times in Victorian poetry, we forget about G.M. Hopkins. We forget about a lot of other questions that are coming from your minor poets also that you have to look into. Okay, so please remember that. Okay, let's come on to the next question. Question number 2. Where did Satan hold a solemn council with the fallen angels? Where did he hold that place? Yes, Bharti, absolutely. Classical literature as well as Indian writers, you know, we have all made proper rosters. I'll be sharing the schedules also. I don't know, where do I keep the notepads? Oh, there, finally I found the notepad, luckily. So yes, of course, the Indian writers as well as classical literature, that would be very good, very good, very good. I'm just writing your suggestions also simultaneously. Also, please put it in the comment section also today. What you guys can do is by before midnight, all of you can actually just put in your comments as to what sessions you would like me to conduct. We'll accordingly conduct your mini modules. Fantastic. All of you have given the right answer. All of you have answered the question correctly. Pandemonium is the right answer. Okay, pandemonium is basically, so this is an anarchic place. Pandemonium means anarchy. Satan's place where he's deliberating. Remember, Satan is actually having the most powerful lines. So it's all in the mind. It can make heaven of hell and heaven hell of heaven. He's also saying it's better to reign in hell than to serve in heaven. So he's of course talking about these kind of notions also. So most beautiful lines given to Satan. Satan's lines are very important. The quotations of Satan are very important. Book 1, book 2, book 9. These are of course very, very important books, but otherwise all 12 books are equally important that you should know about what all is happening. Some of the lines that are coming to vindicate the ways of God to men, the muses that are getting invoked at the beginning, all those questions have also been asked. So Paradise Lost is definitely very important. We have some lectures on YouTube on Milton. You can take a look at them, and in the coming times again we'll be holding certain other sessions also. Okay. Alright, let's come on to the next question. In which year was Tottel's Miscellany published? When are we publishing Tottel's Miscellany? Very simple question. Let's see how many of you are able to get the right answer. Tottel's Miscellany was published in which... And remember yesterday in the application class where I talked about the fact that, you know, where are you able to find the works of Shakespeare for the very first time? So we had talked about Palladius Tamia. If you remember yesterday, I had asked you this question about Palladius Tamia. Palladius Tamia is where you are able to find the first mention of Shakespeare's plays, and someone had written about Tottel's Miscellany, and then we had discussed about the date. So what is the date? Excellent, very good. 1557 is the right answer. Most of you, all of you have become intelligent, huh? Shout outs to all of you. All of you are giving the right answer. That's fantastic. All the students over here who have gathered, that's fantastic to know, okay? Good job. Kudos to all of you. Yes. That's right. Okay. All right. Okay, Ria. Ria's seen the lecture today. Let's come on to the next question. Very, very simple. 10 questions I've included today. So, all of you should actually get the right answers. Let's see what is the correct answer. What is the name of Wife of Bath in the Canterbury Tales? You know, all the names, they're important. Okay, we've got the right answer, I think. Or no? No, we've not got the right answer. Let's see who gets the right answer. Sukirti has given the right answer. Or is it for the previous one? Akshita, Sukirti. No worries. No worries, Rashmi. Everyone's given the right answer. Okay. Alright. Fantastic. Okay. Alright. Someone's like, don't interfere. Alright. Yes. A. Alison is the correct answer. Wife of Bath is called Alison. You know, I was surprised. This question has come 3 times in your exams, right? The main exam, indirectly. So, twice it's come directly and once it's come in, in the match the following. So, you do get easy questions. Don't take it, lightly. Madam Eglante also is equally important. The names in Canterbury Tales are very crucial for all of you to keep in mind. The story of wife of Bath is important, the five husbands that she's having, how she's gap-toothed, right? That is also an aspect that has been asked. Then the stockings that she's wearing, what is that symbolic of? And how, you know, overall the frame is inspired by Boccaccio. So all those pointers are, of course, very, very crucially important. Let's come on to the next question. Let's see how many of you get the right answer. Very simple question. And I'm sure all of you will be able to get the right answer. Very simple question. Okay, what is the correct answer here? Yes, yes, Ranjana, absolutely. Okay, Kavita Verma is saying, Sabka Naam, Sabka Vikas. Okay. I've understood that. Yes, absolutely, Aziz. She was deaf also. And this was also a question that was asked in one of your entrances. Very good, very good. All of you have given the right answer. All of you have given the right answer. Which is the last tale in the Canterbury Tales? The Parson's Tale is the correct answer, right? The tales which are written in prose, the tales which are having their stories, which are the starting, which is the end, your monk's character, many questions have been asked. You've got questions coming from a nun's priest tale as well. The distribution of characters, whether they're ecclesiastical, whether they're coming from the clergy ecclesiastical unit, or they are militia, or they are a part of the nobility. Working classes are of course not included, and cultural studies tells you that why they're not including working classes, right? Okay, let's come on to the next question. Very simple, very, very simple. How many of you will get the right answer here? Yes, that's right. Okay, very good, very good. Chalo, let's answer. How many of you will get the right answer? Bacon was writing. Bacon wrote how many essays and all? How many essays was Bacon writing? Fantastic. Fantastic. 58 is the right answer. 58 essays were written by Bacon. Remember, Bacon is actually the most important person who's actually bringing this aphoristic style of writing. Aphorism is writing via looking at brevity. He's giving us works like the New Atlantis. He's also helping us with works which are predominantly trying to bring this scientific spirit. And I have been stressing a lot on prose writings. Please take prose writing seriously. You can spend 1 or 2 days and, you know, cover all your prose writers entirely, and that will always be very, very helpful. So do cover them. Okay, let's come on to the next question. Very simple again. Okay, all of you should get the right answer here. This is a very simple question. What is the name of the play within a play in Hamlet? The play within a play that we are having in Hamlet. What is the right answer? Excellent, very good. Jinder Mahal. So Jinder Mahal was Chaucer in his last life. Right, Jinder? Some of you. Very good, very good, very good. Yes, of course. Who was this? Who was this? Yes, of course. Who is this? Aniruddha Kumar. Very good, very good. Yes, Saima, we will be discussing it. Don't worry. The murder of Gonzago is the right answer. The Murders in Rue Morgue is written by Edgar Allan Poe, if you remember. Edgar Allan Poe is like a must-read writer also when we are talking about your Gothic writings, American fiction. Here you are having the murder of Gonzago. That is the right answer. The murder of Gonzalo. Gonzalo is a character coming in Tempest, right? And it's not the murder at Baskerville's. It's the Hound of Baskervilles by Arthur Conan Doyle. So that is also not the right answer. The correct answer is Gonzago. This is also called the mouse trap. If you remember, it is called the mouse trap that you are having. It is an example of play within a play. You are having many versions of Hamlet, like the Black Prince, which is coming in, which is telling you about procrastinating the decision that is taken by Hamlet. Okay, we've discussed a lot of these things. Let's come on to the next question. How many of you are getting the right answer here? The only literary epic in English is. Remember, so here, of course, just try and answer it and then we'll see. So this is actually a very, very tricky question. And had this been a subjective question, we would have all justified it. But Beowulf is actually not, because it's a Germanic, example. So Beowulf is not the right answer. Fairy Queen is actually not an epic per se. It's more like an allegory that you are having. All right. So please remember that Hyperion again has got the epical status. But like I said, this is something that all of you can contest. But in English, Beowulf is not written in English. Right, Beowulf is getting translated by Seamus Heaney. Seamus Heaney is translating it in 19, right, in 1999. That is what he's doing, but it's not written in English. This question, to be very honest, had this been a subjective question, any one of you would have written A, B, C. I would have given marks, right? But there was a question that had come in your exam, and the right answer was D. Why? Because whenever you are talking about Paradise Lost, it's always had this epical status. Fairy Queen was an allegory. It was written to kind of please the monarch. And similarly, when we are talking about Hyperion also had a different attitude altogether. Right, but when we are talking about a literary epic, works like Paradise Lost are there. But I will give all of you marks if you are able to justify. If someone's written A, if someone's written B, someone's written C, and you can justify it, you've got the marks. Okay, so don't worry about it. Chalo, come on, let's come on to the next question. I think this is the last question that you are having. Oh, second last, sorry. This is the second last question. Which of the following is a Christian humanistic epic? Christian humanistic epic. Now answer this very carefully. Christian humanistic epic. Okay, so which of the following is a Christian humanistic epic? Okay, what is the right answer? I purposely included these two questions because I know they're like slightly easy, and sometimes these easy questions have got a very tricky answer. Yes, that is right. That is right. Okay. Now please remember again, because the word Christian is added, that is the only reason why you are having Paradise Lost is the right answer. However, had this again been a subjective answer, like I said, a subjective answer, you can put Prometheus bound also. Why? Because Prometheus is trying to talk about this aspect of humanism, how Prometheus is fighting against goddess Zeus to get fire on earth. So you can of course justify this. But most of the times, whenever we are talking about Christian epics, Christian epic is your Christian English literary epic, Christian epic. Paradise Lost is always given that question. But like I said, for this question as well as for this question, all the answers are acceptable. Okay, all your answers are acceptable. This was just like these were just kind of trick questions. Okay, last question. John Donne wrote how many holy sonnets? How many holy sonnets did he write? How many holy sonnets did he write? How many holy sonnets was he writing? Okay, what is the right answer? The last question for today. How many holy sonnets were there? I love sometimes how you all of you give different answers, and then one person is answering, and then everyone's going with that particular question. So holy sonnets are of course a very important piece of work that you all should be aware about. Okay, holy sonnets, the divine meditations or the divine sonnets which are coming in, this is of course a most important piece of writing that Donne is writing. Okay, so do remember it. Okay, all right. Everyone's actually given a different answer. Someone's writing, someone's writing 19. Someone's giving 22. All right. So what is the right answer? What is the right answer that you're having? These are 19 devotional poems. Okay, these are 19 devotional poems that we are having. So holy sonnets, which is also called divine meditations, like I said, it was getting posthumously published in 1633. The publication date has also come in your exams, right? And the edition was called Songs and Sonnets. It had come in Songs and Sonnets. That was there. And how many sonnets are you having? How many sonnets are you having? There are 19 devotional sonnets that it's comprising of. Okay, So these are basically the 19 devotional sonnets that are getting published in 1633. Please remember that, okay? Please remember that. So that is something that you have to keep in mind. Alright, so on that note, we will end. There are some other factors which we'll continue in tomorrow's class as well. Don't worry about it. Also, I would want all of you to put it in the comment section. I have written down two requests, of course, on Indian writers and classical literature. If there is any other request, any other session that you want us to cover, please do put it in the comment section before midnight today, if possible, so that I'll be able to look at the comment section and definitely, accordingly arrange for those sessions. Okay. All right. And I will be giving you an update of the upcoming sessions that are there, both on Sunday as well as on Monday. And I will keep you guys posted about those sessions. Fine. Thank you so much for joining. Do take very good care of yourself. And please be absolutely safe, healthy, and just make sure that you're eating a lot to build that immunity. All right. Take care. God bless. Bye. And of course, if you get a chance, do get yourself vaccinated as well. Right. Thank you. Bye.